It is now time for a question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. Question to the Premier. Premier, yesterday I talked about your failed record when it comes to job creation in the province, that we didn't add any new jobs in the entire year of 2013. And sometimes I'm not sure what's worse, your jobs record or your fiscal record, because now we have, under the Liberal government, doubled our debt, and we have the highest level of debt of any state or province in North America. This is very troubling. Now, the two are related, I believe. So, Premier, would you agree with me that if we want to send a signal that we're open for job creation to restore hope to people in this province, that it's important to balance the budget and pay down the debt as quickly as possible in the province?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I want to just thank the member opposite for the question and to say to him that employment rose in this province by 95,000 jobs, Mr. Speaker, over the last year. He knows that, and I think he knows that since June 2009, we have net new jobs of 440,000, Mr. Speaker. So, in fact, I think he knows that the way that we are working to work with communities, to invest in communities, to work with businesses and partner, Mr. Speaker. I think he knows that that is actually the way to go. We are not going to buy into or support a plan, Mr. Speaker, that would actually push good jobs out of the province, that would undermine labour, Mr. Speaker, and the strategies that the Leader of the Opposition is interested in would actually cut jobs, Mr. Speaker, would cut programs and slash programs across government, and we don't believe that is the way to build to an aspirational future, Mr. Speaker.
Yeah, you know, clearly, Premier, your plan is not working. We're losing 300,000 manufacturing jobs. We're deep in debt, and it seems to be the basic sense that the plan isn't working. You try a different plan. You try a different path. And, well, yesterday, you and the Leader of the NDP were basically arguing over what taxes to raise and when. The Ontario PC Party was laying out our plan to create 1 million jobs in the province of Ontario and restore hope. We continue that path on how we get Ontario working again. My colleague from Etobicoke Lakeshore, Doug Holliday, is introducing a bill later today called the Financial Accountability Officer Act. It would basically compel the new Financial Accountability Officer to look at areas of managed competition to ensure that we contract out where possible, where it makes sense for taxpayers, services who get the best quality at the best price to the taxpayer. Premier, can I count on you to support Doug Holliday's very sensible, thoughtful,
and
forward-looking bill?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And the member's question is about achieving savings. And just yesterday, we announced changes to the public sector retiree benefits, Mr. Speaker, which will save, I think, at full maturity, $1 billion, Mr. Speaker, a year. So that is a very important and significant change. I hope that the leader of the third party supports that and thinks that that is a good idea. I haven't seen the private member's bill that the member for Etobicoke Lakeshore is going to bring forward, but I understand that he couldn't identify any areas where this particular idea would apply. So the notion of contracting out, which I guess is at the root of the issue, he couldn't identify whether he thought contracting out teachers was a good idea or contracting out the police. He didn't have an answer to that, Mr. Speaker. So like the million jobs plan that the leader of the third party talked about, it is magical thinking, Mr. Speaker. We don't engage in magical thinking. We have a plan, and that plan is working.
Final supplementary.
Just try some thinking over there.
You know, back to the Premier, I guess when it comes to our deep indebtedness and creating jobs, I'd wish to engage in any kind of thinking whatsoever. Yeah. We need another plan. Premier, I'm a little worried by your answer that you weren't watching Doug Holliday's press conference. He laid it out. It follows on the Drummond Commission recommendations. Basically, I think there are all kinds of areas. We asked the Financial Accountability Officer to give advice. I'll give you one off the top of my head. The TDSB, under your watch, was paying $3,000 to switch electric circuit. You know, in your own home, if you were to change electric circuit, unless you can do it yourself, you'd look for the best price and the best quality from an electrician. You do that in your home, but Premier, when it comes to taxpayers' dollars, why don't you do the same sensible thing? Why do you lock into a contract that costs $3,000 for something that should be 10 times less expensive and shows respect to the taxpayer in this great province?
Senator?
So I think the Leader of the Opposition knows, Mr. Speaker, that we have already adopted 60% of the recommendations that Mr. Drummond put forward. And I want to talk about our plan, because the Leader of the Opposition, who is engaging in what really is magical thinking, because there are no specifics about how he would move forward, except we know that there would be deep cuts and slashes to programs across government, and there would be laying off of thousands of teachers and thousands of people who work in the healthcare sector. So what we're saying, Mr. Speaker, is we believe that this is a time that we need to invest in infrastructure.
Order.
We need to invest in roads and bridges and in transit, Mr. Speaker, across the province. We believe that skills and
Member from Halton, come to order.
That is an area where there needs to be support. We need to make sure that young
Answer.
People, all of the young people in this room today, Mr. Speaker, have the opportunities to develop the skills that they need to take part in the 21st century. Those are the kinds of investments that
Thank
we're
you.
Making, Mr. Speaker. We think they should come along with us.
Thank you. New question? Leader of the Opposition.
Back to the Premier on the same topic. Speaker, let me give you another example that that Doug Holliday's bill would fix, and why I think that you should support Mr. Holliday's bill. I think it's sensible, it's proven, it's working everywhere else. But for some reason, you're standing in the way here in the province of Ontario. Again, under your leadership, the Toronto District School Board, because they're locked into a particular contract with a government union, paid $143 to install a pencil sharpener.
Listen to it.
$143 to install a pencil sharpener. If you were to go to Staples today, that same pencil sharpener would cost you $20. So I ask you again, Premier, why are you forcing taxpayers to pay $143 for something that should cost $20 maximum?
Good question.
Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I know that the Leader of the Opposition is aware, or I assume he's aware, that the Toronto District School Board is...
The member from Renfrew, Nipissing-Pembroke, will come to order. And as soon as I sit down, the next person that decides to jump when there's quiet, I'll get you too.
My understanding is that the Toronto District School Board is moving to address these issues where there was a contract in place that was not reasonable, Mr. Speaker. But I think it's important to understand that at the base of this question that the Leader of the Opposition is asking is an attack on organized labour. That's actually at the root of it, because this right-to-work legislation that he has proposed, that really is at the heart of his notion about where the economy should go, is an attack on organized labour. It's an attack on the gains that organized labour has made over decades, Mr. Speaker, and in fact would drive our workforce to the bottom, Mr. Speaker. That's where he wants to go. We're not going to go there with him, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
I still understand, Speaker, why the Premier is not supporting such a simple, proven concept. Everywhere else it's been tried, it saved anywhere from 15 to 30% for the taxpayer. Let me take this back to the big picture, why this is important. Not only does it then improve the quality of services, it means we have more money to invest then in maybe that new drug to help treat Parkinson's, to help treat cancer, money that we can actually use to balance the books. And when we send that signal that we actually have our fiscal house in order, we get new investment, more jobs in our province. That means the young people here today from all of Parliament can find their future here in the province of Ontario, not out in Alberta or British Columbia. So I guess, again, Premier, I've given you two examples. I've got a whole list. I can go on, but I don't understand why you don't just give me yes for an answer.
It's a sensible
bill, it's proven, it's thoughtful, and it's about time we made this happen in our province.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, as I say, I have not seen the piece of legislation. I'm happy to read it and to look at it. But Mr. Speaker, if there's anything specific in it, I'm happy to look at that. Again, this is a savings question, and I pointed out that yesterday we announced retiree benefit changes, and I will just say, Mr. Speaker, and correct my record, it's a $1.2 billion savings, Mr. Speaker, $1.2 billion savings over the next 5 years. So my hope is that the Leader of the the opposition would see that that's the kind of move that makes sense, that's the kind of work that we have been doing and we will continue to do. And then he would understand that investing in the future, investing in transit and roads and bridges across the province, investing in skills training for young people, making sure that our young people have opportunities as they are getting in the youth employment strategy for placements and job opportunities. That's the kind of work that is necessary right now, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, you know, again, Premier, I don't think it's standing up for taxpayers when you're paying 10 times the cost for a pencil sharpener. Imagine the cost across government. The Auditor General looked at your own spending in Service Ontario, for example, and found those that were in managed competition for Service Ontario were three times cheaper than those that were government-run. This seems eminently sensible to me. It sends a signal that Ontario is open for business, for job creation again. So I'm on the side of taxpayers on this, and I'm inside of the young people who actually want to find a future in the province of Ontario. The problem, I think, with you is you're on the side of the special interests who are getting rich off of these fat contracts. I guess the only reason why you can't give me a yes or no is you've got
Minister
to
Rural Affairs will come to order second time.
Their permission. Why are you on the side of special interests? Why don't you stand up for taxpayers, get our fiscal house in order, and
make
Ontario open for investment?
You see it, please? Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm on the side of mothers and fathers and grandfathers and grandmothers across this province, Mr. Speaker, who want to make sure that their children have the opportunities that they need. I'm on the side of aunts and uncles who are taking their nieces and nephews to school, who are helping families to get to school, and they need transit, Mr. Speaker. They need transportation opportunities to be able to help their families to get into work and get back from work, Mr. Speaker. I'm on the side of young people who want a good start in life. There are already 7,600 young people who have had an opportunity through our youth employment strategy, Mr. Speaker. I'm on the side of those kids. On the side of those kids who want a future. I'm on the side of middle-class families who want retirement security. That's who I'm on the side of, Mr. Speaker.
You see it, please. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Speaker, my question is for the Premier. I am sending across the Ontario Liberal platform for 2011 to the Premier. These are the commitments that the Premier, as a candidate and campaign co-chair, took to the people when seeking to support to sit here in this legislature. Can the Premier tell me, Speaker, on which page the plan for new tolls?
Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities, come to order. Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I'm happy to have this question, but I really have to say that it is amazing to me that the Leader of the Third Party continues to dissemble on her position in terms of building transit in this province, Mr. Speaker, and investing in infrastructure. It's beyond me how the Leader of the Third Party can actually believe that this is not a moment in our history when we need those kinds of investments, when people need those kinds of investments, Mr. Speaker. We know that productivity is lost because we don't have adequate transit in the GTA. We know that northern communities struggle to pay for their infrastructure, Mr. Speaker, and we know that those kinds of investments are necessary. So I would have thought that of all the people on the other side of the floor, the Leader of the Third Party would have been a champion for those kinds of
investments. You see it, please? You see it, please? I did get a chance to understand one of the words that the Premier said, and I would ask to I would ask the Premier to withdraw.
I withdraw.
Supplementary.
Should know it's not there. In fact, it's exactly the opposite, Speaker. The Premier and her party promised the people that they would not raise taxes on households. As campaign co-chair, is the Premier aware of the commitments that she was actually elected on?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, there's been a lot of talk about change in Ontario, Mr. Speaker. I wasn't the Premier in 2011. I'm the Premier now, Mr. Speaker. We have a new plan, Mr. Speaker. That's what this last year has been about. It's been about a new plan. So, we do have a new plan, Mr. Speaker.
The member from the PN Carleton will come to order. And the member from Leeds Grenville will come to order. Finish, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, the member from the PN Carleton may have liked it when I wasn't the leader, but I am the leader now, Mr. Speaker. And we have a team that is very, very committed to making those investments.
Answer.
I look to the leader of the third party. I hope she will support us in investments in transit and take a position on building infrastructure across the province.
Well, Speaker, it is not just the platform. The Liberals went out of their way.
Sorry. The Minister for Rural Affairs is now warned. Carry on.
It's not just the platform. The Liberals went out of their way, Speaker, to assure people that they would not raise taxes, tolls, or fees. The Liberal leader went further, and I quote, "Ontario families have made their contribution. We will not raise taxes," unquote. The party issued a statement saying, quote, "Ontario Liberals have rejected tolls on existing provincial highways and consistently said no to tolls on the DVP or Gardiner Expressway," unquote. Is the Premier, Speaker, ready to admit that she has no mandate to hit families with new taxes, tolls, and fees?
Thank you.
So, Mr. Speaker, we have been, as a government, investing in transit since 2003, Mr. Speaker. We're going to continue to do that. And so, our position that we need a revenue stream to continue to build transit is completely consistent with what we have been doing. But, Mr. Speaker, I would suggest to the leader of the third party that she be on, that she talk to us about what's going on in her own caucus. Because, Mr. Speaker, there are members who actually agree that this is something that should be looked at. At a public meeting run by Metrolinx, the MPP for Davenport said, "We'll look at revenue tools to make sure they're fair and meet the purpose." And, Mr. Speaker, at that same meeting, the MPP for Parkdale High Park promised to cover 50% of TTC's operational funding, and she said, "Do we need more money for transportation?" Absolutely. That's the NDP, Mr. Speaker. Those are the values that.
Can you please, new question? The Liberal Party.
Premier, Speaker, in fact, the Premier, who's the MPP for Don Valley West, who took $4 billion out of Transit City when she was the minister. Speaker, families haven't seen a raise in years, and they're watching the bills pile up. But instead of making life more affordable, instead of respecting the middle-class families that sent us here, the Premier is telling hard-working families that they're going to have to pay more, even after promising that she wouldn't. What does the Premier have to say to those families, Speaker?
So, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, and I know that the leader of the third party is aware that when I was Minister of Transportation, that $4 billion stayed in the transit bill, Mr. Speaker. It was reconfigured, but it stayed in. It was a slower flow of dollars. She knows perfectly well that that was the case, Mr. Speaker. What I would say to families across the province, Mr. Speaker, is that we're working very hard to make sure that their lives are better, including investing in transportation infrastructure and transit. And also, Mr. Speaker, making changes like changes to the minimum wage and making sure that that minimum wage, as it increases over the coming years, that it is pegged to, indexed to inflation. We're going to be bringing in legislation, Mr. Speaker, to create that indexation. I hope that the leader of the third party and her caucus would support that, Mr. Speaker, because I would think that the NDP would think it would be a good idea to have a rational plan for minimum wage going forward.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, the Premier says she doesn't want to play let's make a deal, but it seems that she can't deal with the commitments that she made families in the last election. Once again, Liberals are looking to hit household budgets with new taxes after explicitly promising that they wouldn't. What does the Premier have to say
to those families,
Speaker?
Thank you, Premier.
Well, again, Mr. Speaker, what I have to say to people across the province is we are going to make investments in transportation, in infrastructure,
Member
including
from Durham, come to order.
We are going to do that in the fairest way possible. What I would have expected, Mr. Speaker, is that we would have had support
Member from Durham, come to order,
frankly,
second time.
Both parties and the opposition, Mr. Speaker, because I know that the PCs understand that having decent infrastructure and having modern infrastructure is important to the economy and actually saves businesses money, Mr. Speaker, but I especially would have expected from the NDP, Mr. Speaker, that they would have understood that that kind of investment is an investment in the future, and it's critical to the future well-being of people across this province.
Yeah. Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, the Premier likes to talk about fairness, but this is what people see, Speaker. New HST loopholes will let corporations write off the HST when they gas up the company car. At the same time as Liberals create a brand new gas tax for the moms in Sudbury or Thunder Bay or Brampton. A party that was elected on a promise not to hit household budgets with new taxes, tolls and fees, getting ready to do it yet again. What does the Premier have to say to those moms and those families?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, again, I really believe that it's important that a government take leadership on the long-term issues that are going to affect people's lives. If we do nothing, Mr. Speaker, as a government, but push aside those long-term issues and hold on to short-term quick fixes, then we are not doing our job, Mr. Speaker. So I would say to the leader of the third party, it would be wonderful if we could have a conversation about retirement security, for example, as a long-term issue that is of concern across the country, Mr. Speaker. I have no idea. I have no idea what the leader of the third party believes about what we should do in terms of retirement security. I believe that having a CPP enhancement would have been the best way forward, Mr. Speaker. The federal government doesn't want to do that.
Answer.
We are going to put together an Ontario plan. I hope that the leader of the third party will see that as worthy of her support, as it will make a huge difference to people and to the future.
New question, the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Premier, I hope I'm reading you incorrectly, because I seem to sense that you've already, I guess, taken a position on the bill that I'm about to put forward this afternoon. I want to assure you that this is not to do with politics. It's to do with good management of the government, and it's to do with the best use of scarce resources, that being the tax dollars. Now, we found out in the municipalities, particularly the municipality of Toronto, that we could save a lot of money if we would just look outside of the way that we're normally providing service. Now, I think that all municipalities should do this, but I think the lead has got to come from the province of Ontario, and that's what the bill is all about. We're asking the Financial Accountability Officer to report taxes on opportunities to use alternate service delivery to save money. Now, this can be done, and it's only a review of the matter, but it needs your support, and I'm urging you to please support it. A lot of money can be saved if we'll do this. Will you support it?
Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, and I know the Minister of Government Service is going to want to speak on the specifics. As I said, I haven't read the bill. I know it was just released this morning, and I was in meetings. I have not had a chance to look at the legislation, Mr. Speaker. I don't know what the specifics are. We are world leaders, as the Minister of Transportation is noting, in our alternative financing procurement, Mr. Speaker. We have developed very strong alternative models of financing and procurement, and we continue to do that work, Mr. Speaker. I understand that the analogy this morning that was made was with the City of Toronto contracting out garbage, Mr. Speaker. Well, we don't pick up garbage. We don't have that function, so I don't know exactly what functions the member is talking about. We'll look at the legislation and we'll take it from there, Mr. Speaker.
It's obvious to me there are two things happening here. Oh, don't point your finger. Don't you dare point your finger. We've got two different conversations going on. That's not helpful, and it's also not helpful to do the shout-down stuff that's happening. So let's just bring it down, please. Supplementary.
Yes, to the Premier, Mr. Speaker. This is also recommended in the Drummond Report. It's in the 40% that you haven't done.
Right.
And it's also recommended by the Ontario Chamber of Commerce that we take a look at alternate service delivery. It's a good way to reduce the cost of this government. It can be done. The City of Toronto could save $35 million contracting out its garbage for the entire city. It should have been done in 2000, but it wasn't done. So that means from 2000 till now, 12 years, they've wasted over $400 million of taxpayers' dollars. And at the same time, they come up here to the province, cap in hand, on one knee, begging for money to balance their own budget when they wouldn't do the things that were needed to do it themselves. Now, I want to put us in the position of being able to balance our own budget, save the money that we can save, provide the service that we need to provide, and do it in the best way. Will you support it?
Be seated, please. Thank you, Premier.
Has it even been introduced yet?
You know, Mr. Speaker, I'm surprised that the member who is the critic for the Ministry of Government Services wouldn't have stood up today and congratulated the government on our move yesterday on retiree benefits, which will save some $1.2 billion. Mr. Speaker, I'm not sure where the member's been the last number of years. I realize he hasn't been in the leadership or in the legislature, but he would have seen, Mr. Speaker, that our government has taken numerous steps to find more creative ways to deliver services to the people of Ontario in an efficient and productive way. But, Mr. Speaker, we have been driven by what makes sense, not by the type of ideology that we've seen from across the way, the type that has led to the let's have right to work for less legislation, privatization. Mr. Speaker, I'm not prepared today to stand here and take lessons from the party that brought us privatization of the 407 and how government can bring forward these services.
No question. The member from Algoma, Manitoulin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and good morning to you. My question is to the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. In November of last year, after Clift announced it would stop operations in the Ring of Fire, the minister hastily announced the creation of the Development Corporation. Several NDP attempts for information on this new Development Corporation were called premature by the government. Even the federal government is requesting details that the province just doesn't have. Last Friday, the minister announced that it had hired consultant firm Deloitte to set up a development corporation, the same development corporation that had already been announced 3 months prior. How much is Deloitte getting paid to come up with a project that the Liberal government already announced it had created?
Thank you, Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Thank you for the question. May I say, Mr. Speaker, despite the lack of support that we're getting from the other side of the House, that we are making important and significant progress on the Ring of Fire. And may I say that the creation of the Development Corporation is absolutely key to that. We recognize there need to be decisions made related to infrastructure. We know that in terms of the project moving forward, we've got to be able to get the resources out of the Ring of Fire and obviously to market. That's why that's so important. And we also, working with our potential partners, certainly including industry, First Nations, and potentially the federal government, hopefully, we recognize that we want to move forward with the kind of expertise that Deloitte can provide to us. They have the governance expertise, they have the legal expertise to be able to pull this together in terms of making the decision on infrastructure.
Answer.
There are other aspects that I do want to speak about, particularly related to how important it is our work with the First Nations, and perhaps I'll get to that in the supplementary.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, again, the minister For the past 3 years, the NDP has been calling on the government to take a leadership role in creating a real plan that will benefit job creation in the province. Time and time again, the government kept using rosy press releases on agreements without facts to back them up. Hiring Deloitte is an admission that the government never had a plan for Ring of Fire development in the first place. Will this government stop giving out consultant contracts to outside firms and do its job by coming up with a serious plan for Ring of Fire development instead of wasting another 5 years?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we've spoken so very often, certainly the Premier has and other members of our government, how important it is to get it right, and indeed it is very important that we get it right. And that's why, indeed, I think this, we're getting support from our industry partners and getting support from many others in terms of the retention of Deloitte being that key to probably pulling the establishment, the Development Corporation together. It's crucial. But also on that parallel path are the very important negotiations that are taking place between the province, led by Frank Iacobucci, and by Mr. Ray, representing Mattawa First Nations. We're working very hard to bring that to a position where we can make a more formal announcement of that moving forward. That's crucial to this as well. I know that the member knows that. But in terms of the Development Corporation, we are moving forward in a very positive way.
Order.
We're getting support for that.
Answer.
For the Development Corporation and support for the work that Deloitte will give in terms of the expertise they can provide to us.
Thank you
very much.
New question, the member from Ottawa.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of the Environment. Speaker, my constituents have raised a number of concerns regarding the previous session. Particularly, they have observed the government's troubles in advancing laws to address the challenges faced by our environment here in Ontario. Mr. Speaker, those who care about Ontario's environment were dismayed to watch the Protection of Public Participation Act addressed on 5 separate occasions over the past 9 months without progressing to a vote. Further, the official opposition ate up much of committee time for the Great Lakes Protection Act, allowing only 4 amendments to be voted on. Mr. Speaker, through you, can the minister please speak to the speed of environmental bills moving through this legislature?
Thank you, Minister of the Environment.
Mr. Speaker, I do understand the concerns of his constituents. Our government understands that Ontario's environment is always fragile. In order to restore and preserve its beauty and value for the current and as well as for future generations, action has to be taken now. And economic and environmental opportunities, I think, are being lost. And that's as a result, I think, of political jockeying, which happens in this House from time to time, mainly when I hear the bells ringing and prolonged debates and so on. Now, I recognize the Conservative Party has chosen to be against many of these environmental initiatives. That's their business. That's why we're appealing to the New Democratic Party to try to form a green majority, if you will, to pass these 4 bills. And I've directed a letter to my good colleagues in the New Democratic Party who have been supportive of this legislation to help us out with this programming motion. I hope they will give it some favourable consideration because
Thank
I think
you.
It would advance the cause of the environment.
I heard the question and it was getting desperately close not to being on government policy, and the minister was good enough to tightrope walk that, but I'm going to ask and listen carefully to the supplementary that it's about government policy. Carry on. And I don't quarterbacks.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Again, my question is for the Minister of the Environment. Residents of Ottawa South will be pleased to hear that our government is seeking the support of the third party to work towards the greater cause of protecting Ontario's environment. Mr. Speaker, it is a shame that the economic and environmental opportunities were lost in the previous session due to political games being played by the official opposition. Speaker, through you, would the Minister of Environment please remind the people of Ontario why we need to pass these important pieces of environmental legislation and how they would ensure a healthier future for our environment and our economy?
Thank you. An excellent question. We need these laws to protect the Great Lakes, for example, and that's Bill 6. We have widespread support for the proposed Great Lakes Protection Act from, well, from health and environmental groups and as well as municipalities. We need to expand recycling. The Waste Reduction Act would, if passed, create new opportunities for business investment and jobs by harnessing the economic value of waste. And we need to these laws to stop polluters from intimidating community groups who are trying to protect their own neighborhoods. Again, I respect the fact that the Conservative Party has decided to be against most of these environmental laws.
Job to be
one not, but most of them. That is why I am asking all members of the House, including my colleagues in the New Democratic Party who have spoken in favor of these bills in the House and in committee, to work with us. We want to get these bills moving so we can continue our consultation with the stakeholders and provide them with the opportunity to present their advice and recommendations to all members of the committee. That's
Thank
the way
you.
The House should work, and I hope that's going
Thank
to be
you.
The case.
New question, the member from the Peel Carlton.
Speaker, my question is to the Premier. During the recent ice storm and the power outage, it was clear that the province's emergency management preparedness plan was either ignored or it was lacking, or perhaps it was both. Whether it was the disregard of basic communications channels of MPPs.
Order. Order. All right, let's go to the people now.
Whether it was a disregard for basic communication channels of operation to opposition MPPs, or the glaring reality that politics, not progress, was behind the giveaway gift card fiasco, it was clear that this government put postal code politics ahead of plan for Ontarians. In the aftermath of the ice storm, the Ontario Progressive Conservative
Order.
Caucus asked for a select committee to study the province's emergency preparedness protocol.
Question.
Quicker response in the future. I'm sending by page over our direct request to the government House leader, as well as our proposal, and I would ask
Thank
the
you.
Premier stand in her place and agree with that.
Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I can tell you, having met every day during the ice storm with the leadership from Emergency Management Ontario and Hydro One, Mr. Speaker, I know that they were on the ground in every community that was struck by the ice storm, Mr. Speaker. They were working hard to make sure that all of those lines were reconnected, Mr. Speaker, and that people got their power back. And they did it, Mr. Speaker, around the clock. There were workers on the ground.
Absolutely.
It was complicated. It was complicated because of the tree coverage, Mr. Speaker. It was complicated because of the breadth of the storm. But the fact is that those workers were on the ground, and their leadership was engaged across government to make sure that every resource, whether there was an emergency declared or not, Mr. Speaker, and the member opposite
Answer.
Knows that there were not emergencies declared except in one jurisdiction, but across the board in every jurisdiction, every resource
Thank
was
you.
Available to communities.
Thank you. The member from Northumberland will come to order.
Here, the workers' leadership is not in question. It is your leadership that is in question. This wasn't just a Toronto issue. Opposition members of the legislature, even from Toronto, never received verbal briefings from you, your energy minister, or anyone over there. You chose to give gift cards out in the city of Toronto, but not to opposition areas until much later in the day. Your own energy minister was missing in action. And I will say this, Minister, you showed leadership.
The Minister of Education will come to order. I'm going to say it again just to make sure you heard it. The Minister of Education will come to order. And then the Minister, the member from Renfrew, is prepared to receive another one. I will give it to him, but he's on the edge. Please finish.
When the Minister Minister of Energy was Mayor of Ottawa and Regional Chair, he actually displayed leadership at a time of crisis. I don't know what has changed with him. Perhaps he's now a lapdog for this government. But what is unacceptable was their postal code politics that were playing
question.
It seems that they could win at the expense of people in other affected areas. Let me ask the Premier this one more time. Will you call the Select Committee?
Thank you.
Will you put progress before politics?
Stop the clock. Seated, please. Premier.
Very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I really have to say that I honestly believe that this is a shameful question, because the fact is that there were people working across the province, Mr. Speaker. The member opposite knows perfectly well that the gift card program, which is a small part of our attempt to offer some support, was offered in every community, Mr. Speaker. Every municipality that was affected was offered, and they took it up, Mr. Speaker, and the member opposite knows that. My understanding, Mr. Speaker, is that the member for Nepean Carleton's office was offered a briefing, and that was declined, Mr. Speaker.
I am looking for some decorum, and I resent when I do get control and we do get calm, somebody uses it as an opportunity to start it again. You have 10 seconds.
That it was my understanding. If that's not the case, then we will look into that. There are two reviews that are happening, Mr. Speaker, as a part of the response to the ice storm.
There's
the after-action report and the supply chain review.
Thank you. Thank you. Your question? Member from Nickelbelt.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
72-year-old Kelly Muayaseyase is a very sick woman. She, like 600 other people seeking care at Trillium Health Group in Toronto, had her CT scan read incorrectly by a radiologist. Due to this error, Mrs. Asayase's cancer was not diagnosed and the treatment was not provided. This hospital has admitted to Mrs. Asayase that they made a mistake, that they made an error. Does the minister think that it is sufficient for the hospital to admit that they've made a mistake, or do they have a responsibility to help and care for patients like Mrs. Asayase, who has suffered because of these errors?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member opposite for the question. And of course, I am prohibited from speaking about individual cases, but I can assure you, Speaker, that all individuals with urgent care needs are treated in our hospital, Speaker, regardless of their coverage. That is an obligation under the Public Hospitals Act that people are treated. Hospitals cannot refuse to treat or admit an individual if the refusal would thereby endanger the person's life, regardless of the individual's residency or insurance status. So, Speaker, this, of course, is an issue that I think everyone is concerned about and are investigating what has happened in this particular situation.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, after months of misdiagnosis, Mrs. Asayase, ovarian cancer, was finally caught, but at an advanced stage. And then the worst happened. Surgeons refused to operate. The family feels abandoned by the healthcare system and by the hospital. They feel that their mother is paying with her life for their mistakes. Speaker, the minister must hold the hospital accountable. She has to make sure that they take responsibilities for their mistakes and the way it impacts patients. When will the minister do her job and ensure that the hospital do their part to help the people affected, like Mrs. Asayase?
Minister.
Well, Speaker, I can assure you that Trillium Health Partners is actively working with the patient and the family to address their concerns. That work is ongoing, Speaker. And I can also tell you that Cancer Care Ontario has put in place evidence-based protocols for determining when patients need chemotherapy or surgery, Speaker. Ultimately, physicians are responsible for making healthcare decisions in consultation with patients and their families. Speaker, I can assure you that people who work in healthcare in the province of Ontario are as fine a group of people as we could find anywhere on earth. They are dedicated to providing the highest possible quality of care to patients. And if something does go wrong, they are the first to look at that and say, what can we do to make sure this does not happen again?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure.
Minister, I'd just like to, first of all, take this opportunity publicly to thank you for taking time recently to visit my own riding of Etobicoke North to make an important announcement, which, of course, will be benefit to my constituents. Of course, I'm well aware of how our government is making record investments in public transit, and of course, these will have echoing and recurring benefits for all of my residents. My constituents rely, Speaker, on GO trains and buses to get to and from work and school, as well as, of course, transport family, friends, and visitors to our vibrant community. The GO system helps to reduce congestion on the roads and helps to keep our air clean. Minister, I'd ask you to please inform this House and through this chamber as well, my own residents, about some of the details of the transit investment that we recently announced together.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I want to thank my friend from Etobicoke North.
He speaks French once in a while here.
Is a huge advocate for transit, and he has fought very hard for the people in Etobicoke North to see some very basic improvements. What we're seeing right now at the Etobicoke North station, Mr. Speaker, is an expansion of the platform so it can handle 12 car trains. Very importantly, the station is being rebuilt so it can be wheelchair accessible, which is a huge priority for us to ensure that we're meeting our commitments to university accessibility. We're improving the bus loop, and as for many Ontarians, heated shelters, Mr. Speaker, which this winter is a particular gift, and also because in communities where people use their cars within those communities, we are adding a 200-lot parking garage, Mr. Speaker, a very big improvement for the people of Etobicoke.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, thank you, Speaker, and thank you, Minister. I'd like to, of course, formally and officially thank you for the update and the upgrade to the Etobicoke North GO station. I know my community continues to benefit from the ongoing investments that our government is making, whether we're talking about health care, community safety, or in this case, transportation and infrastructure. Nevertheless, adding to the list of troubling policy commitments that the Honourable Leader of the Opposition is making, I was a little bit dismayed to learn that he might halt infrastructure spending for communities like mine. Speaker, through you to the Minister of Transportation, would the Minister please inform this House what are some of the investments that we're making in communities across Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, one of the areas that we don't talk a lot about is our highway program, which is almost $3 billion, Mr. Speaker. We're working right now on twinning highways across northern Ontario. The Windsor-Essex Parkway now, not only has it been a success in the sense that we're building one of the most important trade routes, it's actually provoked the construction of the new presidential bridge, the most important trade corridor. But, Mr. Speaker, to maintain economic growth and jobs, we have to spend 5% of our GDP on infrastructure. Anything less would mean a loss of jobs and competitiveness. We're very proud, Mr. Speaker, that after 30 years of less than 0.25% being spent by this government, we are now at 2% of GDP, or about $13 billion. The municipalities, Mr. Speaker, are doing their job. They've reached the 1% goal of GDP. The federal government, Mr. Speaker, as Mr. Flaherty, when he said in this House of the Finance Minister, I commend him. He's been incredibly consistent. He's now got the federal government down to somewhere between 0.25% of GDP, which will kill jobs and undermine the future of our economy.
Thank
Mr.
you.
Speaker.
Question. Member from Simcoe North.
Thank you very much. Mr. Speaker, my question today is for the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities. Minister, you know now by now that your outdated racial system is costing tens of thousands of Ontario citizens, citizens like these young men and women in the audience here today, an opportunity of a good career in the trades. You must surely know that by now. Our young people are taking their apprenticeships in BC and Alberta, while you dither and allow the Ontario College of Trades to become a new barrier for job creation and economic growth right here in this province. You brag about seeing more women and more Aboriginals enter the trades, and yet they are the first to be subjected to your 3-to-1 ratio or system that is costing them valuable opportunities. So when, Minister, can we expect to see you get on the side of young men and women and support the position of Tim Hudak and the PC caucus and support a 1-to-1 ratio system here in the province of Ontario?
Be seated, please. Thank you, Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Okay, with all of these young people here today, what a great opportunity for me to have to smoke out the party opposite on their position when it comes to ratios. I want to say to the young people through you, Mr. Speaker, here today, that when that party was in office in 8 years, they reduced journeyman trade ratios, apprenticeship trade ratios, by zero. The NDP, in all of their years in office, had one. Mr. Speaker, in our years of office before the College of Trades got put in place, we did 8 reductions, 8 times more than the NDP. I can't do the math because they did zero. Since the College of Trades has been up and running, they've done 14 in less than a year. So, Mr. Speaker, we've done 22 trade ratio reductions compared to zero that you did when you were in office. I think that's a pretty darn good track record. I think the people in this audience can add a lot better than you can, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, that is the same boring and uninformed message that you have been subjected to for months. The fact of the matter is that only two trades have been approved by your cabinet: floor covering installer and cement finishers. The other 22 are a joke. You've never approved nothing. Nothing you've approved. And just yesterday, your Ontario College of Trades Regulation Review Committee had an emergency meeting to pass regulations for the now 22 trades that you have been saying are already passed. That following a meeting, a letter to Ron Johnson by the Ontario Home Builders. So you're right into panic mode. So we already know that the ratio review teams are too biased to go to 1-to-1 ratio. But at least, Minister, when will you finally get cabinet approval to change some of the ratios, when in fact you could have done this earlier this year? Mr. Speaker, you could have done it without even forming the Ontario College of Trades. You could have done it for yourself if you want to brag about that. We don't need the Ontario College of Trades. Let's abolish it once and forever. Get rid of this mess.
Be seated, please. Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I think if the member really cared about the people in the audience here today, and if he cared about young apprentices, he would want to support the College of Trades, because the College of Trades, Mr. Speaker, has a mandate to promote the skilled trades with our young people. It has a mandate, Mr. Speaker, to provide skilled trades people with the ability to govern themselves, Mr. Speaker. What he's not saying to the young people here today is he wants to go back to the days where politicians ran the skilled trades, Mr. Speaker. Back in the Tory days when we had zero trade ratio changes. Mr. Speaker, young people in this province don't want to go back to Mike Harris. Young people want to move forward with a Liberal government, Mr. Speaker, that's going to continue to grow the skilled trades, going to continue to help young people get into the skilled trades, and that's what the College of Trades is going to do. Stop the politics.
Answer.
Start standing up for the young people of this province.
Thank you. Question, the member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Community Safety. Speaker, in the wake of the horrendous retirement home fire in L'Île-Vert, Quebec, on January 23rd, the Minister of Health is quoted as saying on CBC, one thing she wants to do is go back and look at accelerating the mandatory installation of the sprinklers. Sprinklers are being installed in older long-term care homes operated by the Ministry of Health as it rebuilds its facilities. But that program is scheduled to last until 2025. Speaker, the Minister of Health says she'll accelerate implementation in government care facilities, but can the minister explain if the government has a plan for protecting the vulnerable people in our province? What are they going to do in the other facilities, and when?
Thank you.
Minister of Community and Safety.
Thank you very much for this question, and I know that the Minister of Health would like to answer the second question. And first of all, it is very unfortunate what happened in L'Île Verte in Quebec. It's very, very unfortunate, and my heart goes to the family who lost a loved one there. We are proud to be the first province to make sprinkler mandatory in existing retirement home and long-term care facilities. We're very proud, and we did it. It was not an easy process, but we did it with everybody at the table. And I want to take this opportunity today, Mr. Speaker, to thank all of those who came to the table and willing to do a compromise to make sure that we will achieve, you know, this very important milestone in the public safety. So let me say again that we are the only government in the country to do this, and we'll continue to make sure that our seniors are safe in the facilities. Thank you very much.
Well, Speaker, the Ontario Association of Fire Chiefs worked on the issue for years with very slow success. From the time I raised this issue until the 2013 consultation, six seniors lost their lives in retirement home fires while this minister did nothing. Those deaths didn't inspire her to get moving more quickly on the issue, but sadly, it seems to have taken the recent tragedy to get her colleague moving on it. Even in the wake of the comments by her colleague, this minister has done nothing to address the implementation periods for the regulations passed by this cabinet last spring. Speaker, will this minister commit to providing an update this week on the status of the implementation of the new regulations and provide this legislature an accelerated timeline for each part of the regulations to protect the people of this province?
Question. Thank you. Minister.
The Minister of Health.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Speaker. And any time there is a tragedy like we saw in L'Île Verte, of course, we all look to see what lessons can be learned, and that's exactly what we are doing, Speaker. I think it's important to note that 70% of our long-term care homes do have sprinklers. The remaining 30% are slated for redevelopment to bring them up to today's standards, which, of course, will include sprinklers, Speaker. Important to note that it's not only about sprinklers when it comes to fire safety, Speaker, and we have taken significant steps to make sure that that all of our residents do are as safe as can be, Speaker. In fact, we've provided $20 million to support long-term care homes to come up to code, Speaker, and to develop evacuation plans, to develop safety plans, enhanced fire detection equipment, fire safety training for staff. All of our long-term care homes must and do have a comprehensive fire safety plan.
Thank you. Any questions, Minister of Scarborough, Agent Court?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Children and Youth Services. In Ontario, we have some of the best and brightest young minds, and what is encouraging many of them are want to give back to their community. They're talented, they're creative, and driven. In my riding of Scarborough, Agent Court, I know many of the young people like Kevin Wong, George Zhu, Alice Wang, Akil Johnson, and Tamara Demara are not afraid to step up in terms of challenge and be part of the solution. Like many young people in Ontario, they need our help. They need mentorship, they need guidance to realize their full potential. In fall of 2013, Mr. Speaker, our government announced new funding for youth programs at Mars Discovery Districts. Through you, Mr. Speaker, can the Minister of Children and Youth Services tell the House what is included in the curriculum of this program and tell us more about the status of this initiative?
Thank you, Minister responsible for Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member from Scarborough Asian Court for this very important question today. The member is right. Ontario has many exceptional, globally minded youth who are passionate about their communities and about making a difference in their communities. And in fact, there are a number of them with us here today. We recognize that for them to realize their potential and succeed, they need to build the right skills, have access to the right resources, and make the right connections. That's why I'm proud that our government is investing in the Mars Discoveries Studio Y Ontario Social Impact and Youth Leadership Academy with our first group of cohorts with us today. Fellows at Studio Y will take part in an intensive skill development curriculum. It will include training on leadership, project management, entrepreneurship, community building, and governance. In January, I had the opportunity to meet the first cohort, and I was amazed by their positive energy. These promising youth have the drive, determination, and talent to become leaders capable of making positive social change in Ontario for years to come.
And thank the minister for the response. I'm pleased to hear that studio-wide program at Mars is up and running. It consists of a promising group of young people. The skills that these young people will develop at Mars will undoubtedly help them and have an impact in the community. When we empower young people through skills and talents, they will also make our province more prosperous and fair and will benefit all of us. Minister, I understand in January during your tour, you made a challenge to the studio-wide cohort. Through you, Mr. Speaker, can you please ask the minister, please share with the House the challenges that she issued to the youth in Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you again. And yes, as I indicated, so the program focuses on community building and good governance. And I wanted to provide the fellows with an opportunity to get involved in shaping actual public policy. As we all know, one of the programs in my ministry is currently the Student Nutrition Program, a program that provides close to 700,000 children each year with nutritious food every day. Some of the agencies that deliver this program have identified challenges in effectively purchasing, storing, and distributing program food. So I issued a challenge to the group. And this is the challenge: to apply their creativity to explore and design innovative solutions to generate greater efficiencies in food purchase, distribution, and storage to maximize the impact of the program. Their work will help us better deliver a great program in schools. I look forward to hearing about their progress and their final recommendations at the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Parry Sound, Muskoka.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. Minister, it has been 3 months since you announced plans for Ring of Fire Development Corporation. Since then, it's become increasingly clear that your November announcement was just a last-ditch effort to provide cover for Cliff's decision to pull out of the Ring of Fire. Now your recent decision to enlist third-party advice has all the makings of another empty press release from a government desperate for a good news story. On the Ring of Fire, your government is big on announcements but very light on specifics. So, Minister, please answer my simple question. Is your much-talked-about Ring of Fire Development Corporation even incorporated?
Listen, we are making very significant progress on the Ring of Fire project, and one of the important aspects of that is indeed the creation of the Development Corporation. And we're working very closely with our many potential partners. We're working very closely now with
the member from Durham will withdraw.
Withdraw, Speaker.
Thank you.
And we're working with their strong support in terms of the retention of Deloitte, which has the expertise in governance and putting together corporations such as this. So we're going to continue to work with them. What we would like to see would be more support, may I say, from the members on the opposite side of the House, perhaps support very directly connected to the federal government. We have made it very clear that we are prepared to make a very significant investment in the Ring of Fire, recognizing how important the infrastructure aspects are in the decision being made.
Thank you.
It would be great to have the federal government on side. The Premier had a meeting with the Prime Minister.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I didn't hear any answer to my question about whether the Development Corporation is incorporated, despite the announcement a few months ago. And I find it hard to imagine how anybody could trust your government on this file. We're still waiting for the thousands of jobs coming to Northern Ontario promised in your government press release dated May 9, 2012. So here we are, 2 years later, and still no jobs. So now your plan is to hire a consultant to provide advice. And we've watched as your government ignored taxpayer-funded expert advice in the past. And it's no secret that establishing a transportation link is critical to the project. So, Minister, why has your government stalled in the past 2 years on creating reliable access to the Ring of Fire?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we have made it so very, very clear how important it is to get this project right, and we're determined to get it right, and we're getting the kind of support that we would like to have in terms of the formation of the Development Corporation from our partners. Very good positive response about the announcement about the retention of a company such as Deloitte with the expertise they have. But it's also very important that we get it right in terms of the work we're doing with First Nations. And again, it would be great to have your support in that regard. I mean, clearly the work that we are doing with the Mattawa First Nations, with our negotiator, Mr. Yakabuchi, Mr. Ray representing Mattawa, is absolutely vital because we need their support. So we're on a parallel path. This project is one that we all need to be very keen on working together on. It's a complex one, but progress is being made in a very, very significant way. And again, it would be wonderful to have your support to persuade the federal government to recognize how important it is that they make a substantial contribution to this project as well.
The Premier on a point of order.
In point of order, Mr. Speaker, I just want to correct my record on the question that was asked by the member for Nepean Carleton. The Minister of Energy's office did offer a briefing on December 24th to the member. Her office replied 6 days later and did not take up the offer. And Energy did provide updates to critics and, in fact, briefed the member for...
Order. There's a fine line between correcting one's record and adding extra comments, and I will take that as an actual corrected record. However, having said that, I'm not privy to the last piece that you said. So. I did see the member from Nepean Carleton rise on a point of order.
The press release that the Minister of Energy's office sent to me, I could have found it on the website, however.
Order. The member on a point of order.
I'd like to introduce Kirsty Landreau and Rhianne Perry, two members of Model of Parliament from the great riding of Bruce Grey Owen Sound. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Speaker, welcome to Melissa Kargianakis from London, Ontario, who's joined us today, and I'm sure learned a lot. Thank you.
A member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
And also from Kitchener-Waterloo, the Model Parliament.
The member from Perth, Wellington, on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to welcome Catherine Hopp and Anna Staffen from my riding of Perth, Wellington.
Yeah, yeah.
There are the member from Eglinton, Lawrence.
I'd like to note and introduce the creator of Gananoque Ale, who's here all the way from Gananoque, Ontario.
Thank you. There are no further. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon. I was ready to say there are no further introductions.